Hello, scholars. My name is Dr. Karis Dillon, and the goal of this channel is to make academic subjects easier to understand. This video is going to be about after the Revolutionary War, and specifically the Constitutional Convention. So when the Revolutionary War came to an end, it was only the beginning for this American nation. One of the founding fathers that had a great amount of influence within the new nation was James Madison. James Madison went to college at Princeton and graduated at 21 years old. He had to decide after college if he wanted to return to Virginia to his father's plantation after college and to be a farmer, or to go on and do something different. And Madison did not want to be a farmer. He didn't have a passion for it, but he wasn't sure what he was passionate about. He tried law school, but he really didn't have very good oratory skills. Madison was humble, he was shy, but a brilliant thinker. He loved reading the great thinkers from all the different generations, including ancient times. He kind of floated around for a while, and in 1774, Madison took this trip with his brother to drop him off at boarding school in Philadelphia. And it's sometimes weird how amazing kind of mundane things, you know, we go to do something, just kind of do something. And that trip actually becomes a great influence in our futures. And that's what that trip was for him. So when they stopped in Boston, Massachusetts, him and his brother found out that the British had closed all the ports in the city. This was because of the Boston Tea Party, where colonists had destroyed over 340 crates of tea, which was worth almost $1 million. And imagine $1 million in the 1700s. Unbelievable. Think about this, it was probably really hard for him not to be influenced by all the demonstrators and protesters that were on the street chanting injustices against the course of acts passed by the British. Now, you're probably wondering, what the heck are these course of acts? Well, there were four different acts that were part of the Coercive Act that was passed by the British right after that Boston Tea Party. So the first one is the Boston Port Act, and this was the closing of all Boston ports until the tea was paid for. The second one was the Massachusetts Government Act, which the British would now appoint people onto town council, and this could no longer be a democratic process. The third act was called the Administration of Justice Act, which stated British officials could not be criminally tried for anything. And then the last act was called the Quartering Act, which demanded that the colonists had to house and feed soldiers in their homes or in the property if that was the British need. The people of Boston were furious with these acts. How could the British monarch and Parliament have such control of a land and people that were over 4,000 miles away? James Madison had a new mission, and after the winter of 1776, he earned his way into the Virginia Convention. He wanted to help create a state constitution that would limit executive power. And when you hear executive branch or executive power, you'll want to think president or prime minister or leader. And then he also, that being Madison, wanted to have frequent elections for legislative representatives. And remember, legislative means the lawmaking branch of the government. Madison tried to have influences from the sidelines. He was young, he was not an extrovert, but he was brilliant. He wanted to add to those ideas. Luckily, older politicians realized how brilliant this young Madison was and kind of brought him into the flock. They were especially impressed by his logic, analytical thinking, and his thoughtfulness. So Madison was appointed to the Governor's Council, where he spent 2 years getting experience in wartime government. So when the Continental Congress met in 1780, Madison became a delegate for the colony of Virginia. Because his father owned a wealthy plantation, Madison could commit much of his time to being a politician. Other delegates have families, they had to work to earn money. They were unable to commit the hours that Madison could commit to the Continental Congress because he was not married and he didn't have a family. James Madison was able to stay in the North for 3 years while he worked with people like Alexander Hamilton. He became a totally effective negotiator, which helped to bring people and their ideas together, and that was so important when we get into the Constitutional Convention. Madison was able to work through the sticking points of the Articles of Confederation and move this forward. Negotiations at the national level were extremely difficult because states had more power than the federal government. This was a definite weakness of the Articles of Confederation. The Continental Congress didn't have any ability to tax either, which meant they really couldn't have any influence or power if they needed it. At another Continental Congress in 1784, Madison started to discuss the need for stronger government, but so many were opposed to this notion. And Madison knew, I gotta hit the books, I gotta research this, I gotta look at the great thinkers and their ideals concerning Republican principles and the benefits of a strong government. And so all this work finally paid off in 1787 when he brought delegates together in a convention. Madison used these years to network and influence individuals at the local, state, and national level. It was obvious this man was a great thinker and the leader of the revolutionary period. Creating a new government that would work for the benefit of all was not an easy task. After delegates declared independence from the British, they had so many issues that they had to debate. Some of the questions that had to be answered were, where would the boundaries of sovereignty lie? What would representation mean? Who or what organization would be able to tax? Who would set the rates of taxation and who would collect those taxes? The more these questions were debated, the more the weaknesses of the Articles of Confederation became evident. As these questions were being debated, more questions came up about the Western lands and the boundaries at the Mississippi River. After the Revolutionary War, there were states that had land claims and others that wanted new states to be created and brought into the Union. Whether Congress liked it or not, there were already Americans moving west of the Appalachian Mountains, and something needed to be decided concerning the land. It was approximated that 100,000 colonists had already moved west of the Appalachian, and it really needed to be decided at this point who owned the land, who would protect and govern it, who would be responsible for governing these people and making the laws, and who would reinforce the laws. When the Articles of Confederation were completed in November of 1777, there was no national executive, meaning no president, no prime minister, essentially no leader. Now, there was also no judiciary, which meant basically no Supreme Court, no court system. And the legislative branch had 2 to 7 delegates from each state that were elected. Now, these delegates were chosen by the state delegates and were reelected every single year. No one could serve more than 3 years. Each state delegate had 1 vote. For bills that weren't important, 7 states had to agree to it to make it a law. For bills that were important, 9 states had to agree to make it a law. If there were going to be any amendments to the Articles of Confederation, all 13 states had to agree to them. Now, it took 4 years for the delegates to accept and pass the Articles of Confederation. New questions, though, of who was free, who could be a voter, and the future of slavery began to arise. The colonists' biggest fear during the Revolutionary War was becoming a slave to the British and its monarch, but now it could be free. Slavery was completely inconsistent with the message of this new nation. But how could Southerners be convinced of this as their livelihood was so economically benefited from it? Man, threaten a person's livelihood and you'll see the true character of that person. In the spring of 1776, states drew up their own constitutions and followed suit. These constitutions guaranteed basic principles set upon the consent of the governed. This was the very definition of republicanism. Many of the states created legislative branches with two chambers. The lower chamber generally was supposed to be closer to the people and had yearly elections. Individuals rotated in and out of office frequently. 6 of the 13 state constitutions had a Bill of Rights. Many of the state constitutions made it a requirement that individuals that held high office had to own a substantial amount of property. In states like Massachusetts, this meant only one-third of all men could qualify for high office. Women and minorities had zero chance of holding office. Abigail Adams wrote her husband so many times how disgusted she was by this. Some of the very first elections that took place in the 1780s, there were groups of women that turned up to vote. The language chosen in many state constitutions did not prohibit women from voting, and harsh debate during state conventions was raised. Debates about property and slavery also came up as varying states disagreed to the definitions of words like life, liberty, and property. In 1777, Vermont was the very first state to create a constitutional draft that outlawed slavery. This spurred a bunch of court cases by black women and men seeking freedom. A woman named Mum Bett was the first individual to win her freedom in a Massachusetts court in 1781. In 1780, Pennsylvania passed their first emancipation law in which infants born to a slave mother on or after March 1st, 1780 would be free when they were 28 years old. This meant no slave could officially be free until 1808. It wasn't until 1847 that slavery was fully abolished in Pennsylvania. Slaves in Pennsylvania often took off and lived with free blacks, and by this point, their owners didn't even try to come for them. Rhode Island and Connecticut came next with their emancipation laws, which were passed in 1784. New York passed its laws in 1799, and New Jersey followed suit in 1804. Every state north of Pennsylvania wrote their views of slavery as inconsistent with the new nation and its ideologies. Now, slavery was still a part of Delaware, Virginia, Maryland, South Carolina, North Carolina, and Georgia's economy. Emancipation bills were brought to trial, but they were rejected outright. It was difficult for the South to know how to make sweeping changes. Even George Washington, the commander of the Continental Army and our very first president, owned 390 slaves and did not free any of them while he was alive. Washington decided to free his slaves in his will when his wife Martha died. There was evidence that Washington had much guilt about having slaves, but wanted Martha taken care of when he was gone. 1 year after Washington, George essentially died, Martha went ahead and freed the slaves. She no longer cared about the income that slaves brought in and felt it was way more important for African Americans to be free in our nation. As the years continued on, it was really difficult to pay off the war debt. During the war, the Continental Congress printed up money or borrowed it from private persons. $500 million of printed money was injected into the economy, which lessened its value. In the 1780s, a man by the name of Robert Morris attempted to correct the country's economic problem. His first idea was to create a 5-cent import tax on products. Now, this didn't work because New York and Rhode Island were against any import tax laws. Now, Morse's second idea was to create a Bank of North America. This bank would hold all the government's hard money, it would grant short-term loans, and keep private deposits. So the bank would use bank notes, essentially pieces of paper that would have a dollar amount printed on it, and the gold and silver would be the hard money that could back up the bank notes. The bank was approved in 1781. Robert Morris also recognized that huge amounts of land in the West could really solve the monetary problems of the nation. So a treaty with certain American tribes was signed and gifts were given. The Seneca Native American tribe was given $5,000 for the area of the Ohio Valley. The U.S. Confederation immediately went to work surveying and developing the area because the state of New York didn't even have $5,000 to give this Native American tribe. So they had to sell it off as quickly as they could so they'd have money to back up that money that they gave. Thomas Jefferson also went right to work, drafting a policy stating a division from north of the Ohio River to east of the Mississippi River, and this would be called the Northwest Territory. Jefferson wanted to give the land to those that wanted to settle it, and he did not want to have to sell it to people. So this would essentially be like a regular grid used to split the land, 10 states, they would have self-government and a road to statehood. So Jefferson's plan was known as the Ordinance of 1784, and everything basically passed except for they did not give the land for free. It only took a year for Congress to revise the law and start selling the land. So the ordinance of 1785 called for 3 to 5 states instead of 10. And it divided into townships 6 miles square. So properties would be sold off in precise squares to make everything easier. There would be one lot of land, though, that would be reserved in each kind of territory for a school. Each piece of land would be sold at a public auction, and there was a minimum price of $1 per acre, but people had to buy 640 acres at a time, and they had to pay with it with hard money or certificates that were earned during the Revolutionary War. The really good land, of course, went for more. The Northwest Ordinance of 1787 provided a plan that territories could achieve statehood. Congress would appoint local magistrates and officials, and they would adopt a legal code. When a territory had 5,000 men that owned at least 50 acres and were of voting age, the group could have its own legislature, governing body, and send a non-voting delegate to Congress. So when the voting population finally rose to 60,000, they could begin writing a state constitution and apply for full admission as a state. Each of these steps required taxation. This ordinance was probably the most important because it meant a great expansion of the country across the West. Congress was able to prohibit slavery in the new states only, though, by agreeing to fugitive slave provisions. This meant escaped slaves caught north of the Ohio River had to be returned to the South. The North at this time became very anti-slavery, and the South stood its ground by remaining pro-slavery. In the 1780s, Congress still needed money to pay off war debts and asked states to voluntarily pay taxes. They called for hard money payments, and farmers grew quite angry and petitioned against it. When the leaves began to fall in 1786, veteran soldiers and officers in the Continental Army, who were now farmers, marched on a courthouse, forcing judges to close their courts and demanding the state constitutions to be rewritten. Local militias did nothing because many of the protesters previously served in the military. One of those farmers was Daniel Shays. He was an army captain from Massachusetts from the town of Pelham. The governor of Massachusetts attempted to make Shays into a villain, and the Boston paper claimed he was trying to burn Boston, Massachusetts to the ground. Shays' ability to congregate thousands of farmers together worried the new government. Congress tried to triple the size of the National Army, but very few men showed up. Governor Bowdoin was given money from wealthy private donors to create a private army, and he put together 3,000 paid soldiers. In January of 1787, individuals learned of a private army coming toward them. 1,500 farmers and other men moved as fast as they could to the Federal Armory in Springfield to get weapons. State militia heard of their plan and got to the weapons facility first, meeting them with gunfire. 4 rebels were killed, while 20 were wounded. In February, Governor Bowdoin's army surprised the rebels in Petersham and took 150 prisoners. The rebels disbanded and Daniel Shays took off for Canada. Bowdoin continued to round up rebels and jail them. About 1,000 men were captured. 2 men were officially executed for the rebellion. 16 were sentenced to death by hanging, but the government decided that if they swore a loyalty to the misconduct, that they could be forgiven. They did so and were told that they could not vote, hold public office, serve on juries, work in schools, or work in taverns for 3 years because of their punishment. Shay's rebellion worried the government because it feared it did not have the national power to put down rebellions in the future, and something needed to change. Government leaders got together and debated whether or not the Articles of Confederation could be amended to fix the problems that were arising from a weak national government. Most of these discussions came from Virginians, and by this time, James Madison was 35 years old and was part of the Virginia Assembly. After one failed attempt to meet in Annapolis, Maryland in September, James Madison was finally able to get delegates of various states to meet in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania in May of 1787. The goal was to amend the Articles of Confederation, but Alexander Hamilton had something totally different in mind. Hamilton wanted to strengthen the power of the federal government, and after much debate, the meeting turned into the Constitutional Convention. There were 55 delegates that showed up for this Constitutional Convention, and everyone knew there were problems with the Articles of Confederation. Now, Patrick Henry didn't attend. He said he didn't trust some of the people there and that he, quote unquote, smelled a rat. Rhode Island chose not to send any delegates either. Two of the delegates from New York took off in the middle of the convention in disgust, which meant that Alexander Hamilton was the sole delegate left from New York. It was really important to the delegates that the meeting, though, be secretive. They wanted to explore ideas and alternatives to this government without statements they were saying coming back to bite them in the future. At the very beginning of the convention, the Virginia delegation provided a 15-point plan for restructuring the whole government. Now, many of these changes were created by James Madison. Madison proposed a 3-branch system. Branch 1 would have a 2-chamber legislature. Branch 2 would have a powerful executive, and Branch 3 would have a judiciary. This plan was hotly contested because the smaller states felt like their voices would no longer be represented by this model. This plan would make population the base of representation, and where would this leave the voice of the smaller states? The delegates continued to debate this proposal, and in the summer, a delegate from New Jersey brought forth a plan called the New Jersey Plan. This plan said that 3 men would serve as the executive branch, essentially 3 presidents or 3 prime ministers. It would give much more power to Congress. They would have the ability to tax and to use force against unruly state governments. Now, this plan definitely favored more national power over states' rights. It was aligned more with the Virginia plan, but it kept the delegates in a heated discussion about the future of the nation. In the middle of July, the Great Compromise was finally proposed. This proposal called for the lower chamber of the legislature to be based on population. Now, what this meant is that the population of a state would determine the amount of delegates, or what we call today representatives, it would send to the lower house. Now, the lower house eventually became known to us today as the House of Representatives. The upper chamber of the legislature would have 2 delegates from each state, no matter the population. The upper house eventually became known to us today as the Senate, and its members were known as senators. More questions arose as delegates questioned how slaves would be counted in consideration to population. Eventually, delegates created the 3/5 clause. It is interesting that nowhere in the Constitution are the words slaves or slavery printed, because many of the founding fathers did not want that language in this historical document. but essentially slaves would be counted as three-fifths of one person. This new government presented more checks and balances on the branches of government. Now, the upper and lower houses could perform checks and balances on each other. The federal government could check and balance the state government, and the executive and judicial branches could check and balance each other. The lower house, now known as the House of Representatives, would re-elect its representatives every 2 years. The upper house, the Senate, which we call today, would re-elect its senators every 6 years with no limits on re-elections. The founding fathers wanted the Senate to show more maturity and experience in office. Congress was given the powers through the Constitution to hold the purse strings. They could essentially levy taxes, they could coin money, they could deal with aspects of currency. They must provide for the common people, provide defense, and they could regulate trade. Their biggest job, though, was to pass laws for the nation. It was also at this time that the Electoral College was created. Now, its function was to elect the president and the vice president. The state's electors, which was the sum of the state's representatives and the senators, would choose the president of the United States. The original function of the Electoral College was to blend the idea of each state having an equal say, but also population playing some role into who gained the executive office for presidency. The founding fathers gave the executive branch the ability to veto Congress, but they also gave Congress the power to override presidential vetoes. The president also had the power to propose laws, command the military, control foreign policy, and appoint the judiciary with Senate approval. There was an incredible amount of debate and compromise that came about during the writing and constructing of the U.S. Constitution. Not one delegate there was completely satisfied with it. When a vote was finally taken at the Philadelphia Convention in September of 1787, only three individuals refused to sign it. 39 individuals signed it. The others that were there simply left. Many wondered how they were going to sell this to their states and to their citizens. In the U.S. Constitution, it stated that in order for the document to be accepted, 9 states would have to ratify it, meaning accept it into law, making it valid. Those individuals that were for this new Constitution were called the Federalists. When the convention was finished, the Federalists moved into action very quickly. They immediately went to states that were most likely to ratify it or validate it and began convincing citizens of the greatness of the document. By December the same year, Delaware unanimously ratified the U.S. Constitution. It took another month, and Pennsylvania, New Jersey, and Georgia followed suit. Connecticut, South Carolina, and Maryland were the next to ratify it. This meant the U.S. Constitution now had 7 states and had accepted and validated the document. The Anti-Federalists were slow in putting together their campaigns together against the document. Federalists were generally elites and intellectuals that had more time and money on their hands. The Anti-Federalists were generally Western, rural, and non-commercial men. This made it more difficult to get their message spread. Massachusetts was the one state that was really tough for the Federalists to convince of ratification. The newspaper provided a forum for the Federalists to plead their case. The Federalists won by a very small percentage, and they had to promise that they would make amendments to the U.S. Constitution when Congress met for the very first time. Now, there were 8 states that had ratified the U.S. Constitution. Anti-Federalist states wanted to be more independent and didn't want their freedoms to be squelched. Having 8 states already ratified it, though, worked against the Anti-Federalists. This was a big surprise to the Federalists. Anti-Federalists worried that the new powerful government might become tyrannical and corrupt. They also questioned how one delegate in Congress could represent 30,000 people in their own state. They would certainly lose out on the belief systems of their own constituents. Anti-Federalists also didn't like the fact that their states could not print money. the Federalist government now wanted to control the time and the place of elections, leading to the disenfranchisement of the poor and rural people. The Anti-Federalists lost their fight on June 21, 1788, when New Hampshire ratified the U.S. Constitution. Now that 9 states had officially ratified the U.S. Constitution, it was considered valid and law. Congress did not want to see other states sit outside the Union, though. Virginia eventually ratified the Constitution due to George Washington and James Madison's influence. In order for New York to ratify the U.S. Constitution, Madison, Hamilton, and John Jay wrote 85 essays to put into New York newspapers. They were later published into what were known as the Federalist Papers. They were written in such a way as to expertly argue the deficits of the Articles of Confederation. These papers really seemed to do the trick. Even though Anti-Federalists dominated New York's convention, lobbying and passionate debate changed its fate. The Anti-Federalists agreed to ratification if their original list of individual rights would somehow be protected. After New York ratified the U.S. Constitution, it took another 18 months before North Carolina did the same. Rhode Island held strong until May of 1790 before it finally ratified it. 13 states validated the U.S. Constitution and history was made. If you like this video, please click on that like button and subscribe. Our next video is going to walk through the U.S. Constitution so you can understand it without any problem. I want you to have a wonderful morning, afternoon, or day, whatever it is to you. And this is Dr. D signing off. Talk to you later.